2003. Now, in the last lecture, we saw that there is this Josephson effect, that when you take two superconductors separated by a very thin narrow strip of a normal region or a weak link whose size is of the order of coherence length, then you can push in a current without any dissipation or any voltage, okay? And you can send in currents which are of the order of the critical current of the superconductor, okay, of the junction, okay? This is JC or IC. I is equal to up to currents of the order of IC you can send in with V equal to 0. We saw this, and this is the critical current of the junction. Critical current of the junction. The maximum current that you can send in with V equal to 0 across this sandwich structure is determined by the critical current of the junction. Now, how do you understand this process? That how can you send in current without creating any dissipation when you have this normal barrier which is sitting out here? Okay, the way to understand is that you have on the superconducting side, you have a macroscopic wave function. You know that the entire system condenses into a single state, a single macroscopic quantum state where particles are forming Cooper pairs and all the particles are behaving in unison with each other. So you write the wave function of the system as psi is equal to psi naught e raised to I delta 1, where psi naught is the amplitude of the wave function is nothing else but square root of density of Cooper pairs ns. This is the density of Cooper pairs. Pairs in the system. And similarly on this end, psi is equal to psi naught e raised to I delta 2, where delta 2 is the phase and psi naught is square root of ns. Let us take two same superconductors on both sides. The only difference between them is the phase, that there is a relative phase difference between them. Delta is the phase difference, which is delta 1 minus delta 2. Okay. Now, what happens is that you have this wave function, and this wave function is constant up to far away from this boundary between the superconducting and the normal region. So far away from the boundary between the superconducting and the normal region, you have the wave function which is finite and fixed. As you approach the boundary, you know that over the coherence length xi, over a size of coherence length, this wave function is going to decay out, okay? Because this normal superconducting boundary is not a sharp boundary, the wave function will decay over the system, and a part of this wave function actually tunnels across this normal superconductor interface, and a part of it actually enters or slips into, so a part of this wave function actually slips into the or leaks into a part of this wave function actually partially leaks into from the left side. Let us say this is the left side and this is the right side. From the left end of the superconductor, a part of the wave function leaks into the right side, and similarly from the right side, a part of the wave function actually leaks into the left side. Okay, so if this normal interface is very thin, okay, that is why we call it of the order of superconducting coherence length, then part of the wave function from the right side can actually leak into the left side, and part of the wave function from the left side can leak into the right side. So you have these currents which are actually, so if you apply a current into the system, you will have currents which can leak in from either side. Okay, and now how much current is going to flow will actually, so you have currents which are flowing back and forth across this junction, and they will interfere. Okay, you have this wave function from one end and this is the wave function. There is only a phase difference between them. So there will be some sort of an interference between these two wave functions. So from one end, you have a wave function which is coming, and from the other end also you have a wave function which is coming, and then it decays out, and these two wave functions actually, the wave functions actually interfere in this intermediate regime, and in this intermediate regime you will get an interference because of the interference of these two wave functions which are coming from either end of the superconducting side. So this is from the right side and this is from the left side. You have this wave function which sort of oscillates with a phase delta one, this one with a phase delta 2, and in between this region there will be, depending on the phase difference between the wave function, you can have either constructive or destructive interference of these two wave functions. So now this is how the Josephson junction operates. If the difference between the wave functions is finite, you can send in a current. If the difference between the wave functions becomes zero, then you cannot send in a current. Okay, now what happens is that when you apply say between these two, if you apply say current bias to the system, you try to push in current, the difference between the delta difference between them will try to adjust itself. The phase difference between these two junctions, as long as current I that you're pushing into the system is less than IC, the phase difference between them will adjust itself so that you can push in this current up to IC. So up to IC, so if this is current and this is voltage, you can send in a current up to IC, okay, or plus or minus IC. You can send in, depending on the orientation, either you are sending current in this direction or you are sending current in the opposite direction. The phase difference between these two superconductors will adjust themselves so that you can manage to send in a current with plus IC or minus IC. Okay, that's the important aspect of it, that the phase difference adjusts itself in this sort of an experimental situation. The phase difference adjusts itself so as to accommodate this current, which can flow from left to right or from right to left. But all of this current is dissipationless, and the dissipationless is because the dissipationless nature is because of the tunneling of the superconducting order parameter from either ends. And in between they will interfere such that the phase difference. So how much current you can actually send in can be controlled also by controlling the phase difference between the superconductors. In this sort of an experiment where I am sending in current, the phase adjusts itself. If I have zero voltage appearing across the superconductor, the phase difference between the superconductor just adjusts itself so that you can send in positive current or negative current. For example, if I want to send in positive current up to IC, for positive current up to I equal to IC, up to IC, then plus IC, then the phase difference delta between the two superconductors that will be maintained will be of the order of pi by 2, or and for I up to minus IC, the phase difference will be minus pi by 2. It will maintain this phase difference so that you can send in the current, either positive current or negative current across the junction. Okay, so the phase difference between the superconductor, they will adjust themselves to accommodate the current, and the relation that turns out between the phase difference between the superconductor and the current is I is equal to IC sine delta. This is the first Josephson relation. Okay, if I represent JP as Josephson, okay, this is the first Josephson relation, a very important relation. We will derive it when we discuss the Josephson junction in more details, but the physics of the Josephson junction is essentially what I have just described to you, that it is the leaking of the wave function across from left to right and right to left because of tunneling of Cooper pairs across the junction. And if your junction is of the order of the coherence length, then this leaking is possible. If you make it very wide, then if you make the normal region very wide, if you make it much thicker than the coherence length, then your order parameter will just die out inside the superconductor. Namely, if you make it very thick, if you, for example, if this is my superconductor on the left side and this is my superconductor on the right side, and my normal region is actually very thick in between, okay. So if my normal region becomes quite thick, this is my normal region whose thickness is much greater than xi, then the order parameter from this end of the superconductor will die out, and from this end will die out, okay. So you are at a thickness much greater than xi, and so the order parameter from one end to the superconductor other, they don't have a way to feel each other or interfere with each other. So you cannot have coherent tunneling of Cooper pairs from one end to the other. Okay, so coherent tunneling of Cooper pairs can only occur if the two wave functions feel each other and there is a positive creative, there is a constructive or destructive interference. Okay, so that will allow Cooper pairs to tunnel from one end of the superconductor to the other. If you make the normal region too thick, then it actually, the wave function decays out completely before it can reach the other superconductor and cause a coherent tunneling of the Cooper pair. It is already lost. The superconducting Cooper pair breaks up in the normal region and there is no superconductivity left in the system. So you cannot send in with zero voltage, you cannot send in current from one end to the other. Okay, so but if you make this thin enough, then you can have a coherent tunneling of Cooper pairs from one end of the superconductor into the other. Okay, send in currents with zero dissipation junction through this superconductor normal superconductor interface, and this is basically the Josephson junction phenomena. Now for the structure that we have just discussed, namely two superconductors separated by a normal interface in which I am trying to push in current, either positive or negative current up to IC. The current that I can send in is up to IC, and delta is the phase difference between the two superconductors. The phase difference intrinsically changes so that it can accommodate the current that you want to send into the superconductor as long as it is less than IC, and so that you can have a coherent tunneling of Cooper pairs because of the overlap of wave functions from either ends of the superconductor. From the left and right ends of the superconductor, the wave function leaks in through the thin supernormal barrier and they enter into other regions so that the Cooper pair can coherently tunnel across the Josephson junction. And whether the current is flowing from right to left is determined by the phase difference, which adjusts itself depending on the external circuit conditions. Okay, however, is there a possibility to adjust the phase of the superconductor? The phase difference that you have delta out here, is it possible to adjust this phase difference so that now by applying a voltage, can you control the phase difference externally so that you can control the current that you're sending to the junction? For now, we have been discussing that you can send a current to the junction and the phase difference will adjust itself so that it can accommodate the current. But is it possible that you can control the phase difference so that you can control how much current you're sending through the junction? And that is the interesting aspect of Josephson junctions, is that it is possible to do so, and that is given by the second equation of Josephson junction. So you have a second equation, this is your first equation, and the second equation of Josephson relation is that, let us write down that relation, that the rate of change of this phase difference between the junctions is 2EV by H cross. This is your second Josephson relation. Namely, the rate at which the phase difference between the two junctions changes depends on how much voltage that you apply across the junction. So, if I take these two superconductors, with a normal Josephson junction in between, this is your normal region, and now I make this circuit where I apply a voltage and I measure the current which is going across the junction, and at the same time I can also measure how much voltage drop is being appearing across the junction. So now I intentionally apply a voltage across the junction, then what will happen is that if I apply a finite voltage, any finite voltage across the junction, okay, then you will find that for any finite voltage, the phase between the phase delta 1 and this is delta 2, the phase difference delta, which is delta 1 minus delta 2, evolves as a function of time, which is given by this formula, okay, and this tells you how you can control the phase difference between the two junk, between the two superconductors. The phase difference delta 1 and delta 2 is controlled by the voltage that you apply across the junction, and by controlling the phase difference you can of course control the current. And what this leads to is the AC Josephson effect, because say I apply a constant voltage V0 between the junction, then from the above equation, from the second Josephson relation, you can see that delta is equal to some initial delta naught. If I integrate the above equation, then it is 2EV0 by H cross into T. Okay. And this dimensionally has units of frequency. Delta is equal to delta naught plus omega j. So let us write this as omega times t, where this frequency omega naught, this frequency omega, a controlled frequency, because by changing the voltage you can change the phase, and this units of this is in frequency terms. So by changing the voltage you can actually change this frequency. Okay, now this is this frequency. Okay, so you can omega by V is 2E by H cross, which is nothing else but a fundamental constant 2 pi by phi naught, where phi naught is the flux quantum A by T. There is a C or mu naught, 1 by mu naught and so on, which I am putting those units as equal to 1. Okay, but this is your flux quantum. Okay, so this frequency unit per unit volt is a fundamental constant. You can write it in terms of fundamental constants of electric field and your Planck constant. Okay, or you can write it as 2 pi by phi naught. Okay, where phi naught is your flux quantum. Okay, and this is a very important unit. Okay, which is called the Josephson unit, and it is used to define 1 volt. Okay, your volt, 1 volt, for 1 volt your omega is equal to omega j, your omega becomes equal to omega j, which is written in terms of your fundamental units 2e by 2e by h cross. For a voltage V equal to 1 volt, for an voltage V equal to 1 volt, the frequency of the Josephson junction is 2E by H cross. Okay, and this, or it is equal to 2 pi by phi naught, and the value of this frequency is 483.6 × 10⁻ hertz. Okay. So this is a very important frequency. It is like a frequency standard. Okay, you use a frequency standard to define a voltage. So currently Josephson junctions are used to define 1 volt. Josephson junctions are used to define 1 volt. So the frequency standard becomes, because this frequency is written in terms of fundamental constant, so this frequency becomes the standard unit to define, this becomes a frequency standard to define 1 volt. That in Josephson, 1 volt is that volt at which the current in the Josephson junction fluctuates at a frequency omega j. Because you remember d by delta, the rate of change of the phase difference by H cross, which gives us delta is equal to delta naught plus omega t. And if I recall from the first equation, the current in the Josephson junction is sine delta. So this becomes equal to I naught IC sine delta naught omega t. So the current through the Josephson junction now starts becoming an AC. The current through the Josephson junction now is an AC current. This is an alternating current. The moment I apply a voltage across the Josephson junction, the current through the junction becomes an alternating current. Okay, where the delta, the phase difference between the junction evolves as in this form. The phase difference between the junction delta is delta naught plus omega t. This is how the junction is evolving. Okay, the phase difference between the junction is evolving, and this is the gives rise to the AC Josephson effect. Okay, so if I take this junction and I apply a voltage difference between it, and if I measure the current, then this current as a function of time, this current time which is going across the junction, because delta is evolving as delta naught plus omega t, where omega is equal to 2 ev by h cross, then it is oscillating with the current across the junction starts oscillating between plus and minus ic that you get across the junction. So the current increases, hits IC, decreases and increases continuously between plus minus IC, and the frequency of this is the time period by omega. If you try to measure the average current through this junction, the average current through this junction will be zero, because this frequency is at a very high frequency. Okay, it is occurring at 483.6 into 10 raised to the power of 12 hertz. So the average current through the junction becomes zero, and this is the AC Josephson effect. Okay. However, there are circuits which are there to actually measure this sort of a junction. Okay. And there are circuits which are used to actually measure these junctions. I will not get into those circuits immediately. Okay. Let us look at the behavior in the next lecture. Let us look at the behavior of this Josephson junction in a magnetic field. The behavior of a Josephson junction in a magnetic field. Okay. Shit.